Hi all, welcome to Smart Leaders IAS. In our Smart Catalyst main series, today we'll be discussing about the surveillance regime. The cybernetics of the interconnected communication network with electronic devices has made the world smaller. And because of this interconnected world, data has become a pivot for driving growth. This is the positive aspect of using data. Apart from being a positive agent for change, data can also act as an tool for surveillance. We might have heard about this particular term called surveillance capitalism. In surveillance capitalism, what happens? Under surveillance capitalism, the capitalist invests more on technologies that collect, collate and corroborate data. Based on these three C's, they try to influence the free will of consumers. This violates the principle of free market economy. Apart from having an impact on economy, this capitalist also use the data about an individual citizen to use them in election processes. The recent example of Cambridge Analytica indicates how far data profiling of an individual would lead to political change. So this is all about the surveillance capitalism. Apart from the surveillance followed by the capitalists, now the governments of the various countries are taking surveillance in their hands in the name of national security. First, recently the Chinese government had launched its national surveillance program through which the citizenry of the China are given points based upon their actions. For example, they would be given a merit point if they follow the traffic signal. So they collate the points gained by every citizen and based upon which their public utility services access would be decided upon. This violates the moral responsibility imbibed in the social contract that exists between a citizen and the government. Now, the government of India, through the provision of Section 69 of Information Technology Act 2000, has provided powers to 10 central government agencies to surveil upon the computers of the individual citizen of India in the name of national security. This has received widespread criticism from public intellectuals, advocates of privacy and human rights activists. Pertinent to this, we will see what are the existing surveillance regimes in the country and what are the flaws associated with it. And after seeing that, we will be looking into the measures to be undertaken in the name of national security without violating the privacy of individual self. Surveillance by itself is a confusing and complex task, but surveillance has been the important tool for the governments. Not only the modern governments, even the ancient kingdoms like the Maurya in ancient India, they were all dependent on surveillance and reconnaissance agents. With the evolution of time and evolution of technology, the surveillance methodologies have varied. Earlier, the surveillance techniques involved humans. Now, with the advent of technology, the humans are surveilled upon by the machines. And this surveillance is mentioned as an important tool for the governance, not only in the modern text of national security, even in ancient texts like Arthashastra. With the development of technology, initially the word of mouth was a communication tool, later letters, then came the telegraphs, then came the telephone, then came mobile phone, then came connected internet connected communication networks. With rise of every new technology, new methodologies for surveillance were introduced. So surveillance is by itself is a complex and evolving phenomenon. This is not static, whereas surveillance is a dynamic phenomenon. So what are the two important statutes that govern surveillance in India? The two statutes are Telegraph Act 1885 and Information Technology Act 2000. The telephone surveillance is sanctioned under this Telegraph Act 1885. The contemporary period is an epoch of digital communication. With that, the need for electronic surveillance have increased for the national governments. So the electronic surveillance has been introduced under the ambit of Information Technology Act 2000 by the government. The existing surveillance regime in India has been criticized in three fronts. And we'll be discussing about those three areas under which the surveillance regime in India is criticized. The first criticism is about the lack of comprehensive control over the surveillance regime. The act provides that any surveillance action to be undertaken over an individual should get approval from an officer at the level of Joint Secretary. This is giving extraordinary power to the executive organ of the government. We all know that any democratic government has three pillars. One is executive, second is legislature, and the third is judiciary, giving overarching power to one organ of the government would diminish the or would decimate the equilibrium and balance existing between three organs of democracy. So providing excess power, vesting the powers of approving surveillance only with the executive violates the basic tenets of democratic government. And here the executive has the power to approve, but at the same time the process is not supervised either by legislature or by judiciary. This indicates the overarching power available with executive. The second criticism is about the lack of proper definition of the grounds upon which the surveillance can be initiated. The Section 69 of the IT Act has taken the provisions directly from Article 19 of the Indian Constitution. We all know that Article 19 of the Indian Constitution speaks about right to freedom of expression as in any fundamental right. The right to freedom of expression is not absolute. It is governed by reasonable restrictions. The reasonable restrictions include security of the state, integrity, sovereignty, public order, morality, and friendly relation with foreign states. This might seem to be an proper definition of the grounds upon which surveillance can be initiated. But the problem is that the provisions present in the Constitution of India under Article 19 is too generic. And surveillance which violates the basic privacy right of every individual should be based upon specific grounds, says the critics. So this is the second criticism upon the existing surveillance regime in India. We saw who has the power to approve a surveillance, and then we saw the flawed definition of surveillance in Section 69. Now, the third criticism is about the lack of information available about the basis on which the surveillance decisions have been undertaken. Also, the legal standards, there is also lack of information over how the legal standards in a democratic country is applied in the area of surveillance. These three are the criticisms against the existing surveillance regime in India. Now, with the powers conferred under the Section 69 of Information Technology Act 2000, along with the Information Technology Rules 2009, the government has provided powers to the competent authorities and intelligence agencies to intercept, monitor, and decrypt any information generated, transmitted, received, or stored in any computer resource within the territory of India. So the government has conferred powers to these 10 authorities. It includes Intelligence Bureau, Narcotics Control Bureau, Enforcement Directorate, CBDT, Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, Central Bureau of Investigation, that is CBI, NIA, Research and Analysis Wing, Directorate of Signal Intelligence, which is working on the disputed and conflict-prone areas like Jammu Kashmir, Northeast and Assam, and Commissioner of Police Delhi. There has been criticism about the already existing surveillance regime in India. Without answering to those questions, now the government has given overarching power to the 10 government agencies to infer, monitor or decrypt any information stored in the computer resources within the territory of India. And this has become bone of contention between the activists of civil rights and the government. Apart from being a burning issue for personal liberty, this area has probability of being asked in GS2 under the Indian Polity Area. Apart from that, in GS3, in national security, cyber security, and how recent government actions has helped in curtailing the dangers posed to national security. And in GS4, violation of individual autonomy, violation of privacy becomes an ethical question. So we might expect question in this area from three GS papers, GS2, GS3 and GS4. So it becomes important even in that perspective. We saw in the earlier slide that even the right to privacy is not absolute. Any individual can enjoy privacy and personal freedom unless and until they infringe the freedom and privacy of other individual. In the Puttaswamy case, the Supreme Court had mentioned in its judgment that privacy is the right to left alone, which means the privacy also includes the right of an individual to live without any disturbance. A nation is nothing but a collective unit of individuals. Individual privacy amplifies to a national privacy, which is equivalent to national security. For a individual to be left undisturbed by any agents, privacy is required. For the same time, for a nation to be undisturbed by any external agents like security threats, it is pertinent for the government to have surveillance. So, surveillance is essential in order to ensure national security and to preempt terrorist attack. As we discussed earlier, the surveillance regime in India now is heavily bureaucratized. The surveillance regime in India today is heavily bureaucratized. And this bureaucratized regime doesn't provide any chance for enhancing national security. Rather, it is creating significant privacy loss. We earlier saw that the right to privacy is not absolute. At the same time, the violation of privacy in the name of surveillance, it is also not absolute. Any impingement upon the right to privacy should be proportionate. In the Puttaswamy case, the Supreme Court mentioned about a ring test for privacy. Any governmental action violating privacy would not be declared unconstitutional if and only if that governmental action passes through this ring test. So, in a democratic setup, the government role is diversified. One of the primary goals of a government is to guard the nation from external threat, that is national security. The second is to provide proper space for the citizens to exercise their personal liberty. Here, in the case of surveillance, the personal liberty and national security are considered to be an overlapping spheres. Rather, they are mutually inclusive spheres. The goal of protecting national security can be achieved by small infringement of the two primary objectives of a democratic government. Both share equal weight. So, impinging upon one area, that is the fundamental rights of personal liberty of an individual to provide maximum welfare for the country in the name of national security, is not violating the basic tenets of democracy. But those measures should be constitutionally bound. No space for overarching power to a particular organ. It should be the rule should be stipulated and it should be constitutionally bound. And what should be the way forward? Now, we will be discussing the way forward to handle the dilemma between national security and individual liberty of a citizen. As we saw earlier, the existing surveillance regime in India is based upon arbitrary and unequal power to executive. So, providing space for judicial authority to approve an initiation of surveillance process should be brought in. And the application of independent legal mind in the merits of requires, it will create more avenues for constitutionally bound infringement of fundamental rights. Apart from the constitutionally allowed surveillance measure, there has been many unconstitutional surveillance actions being undertaken by various organs. These unconstitutional surveillance action, they produce certain evidences, and these evidences are admissible in court. So, this encourages agencies to undertake unconstitutional surveillance measures. The second recommendation is to make these unconstitutional surveillance inadmissible in court. As we saw earlier, in the area of judicial approval, the need of independent legal mind to analyze and to understand the merit of the surveillance request. The directive principles of state policy in Indian Constitution has provided directives to the government in order to guard the fundamental rights of the people. They should be given free legal aid, and this free legal aid should also apply to the targets of surveillance. Apart from all these, there is a lack of structural coherence in surveillance framework in India. So, the government of the country should provide space to undertake comprehensive reforms in order to strengthen the surveillance framework in India. Without these measures being undertaken, the country would become a panopticon. It is now important for the government to look back at its surveillance framework. Now, it is time for the government to undertake a comprehensive reform of its surveillance framework, without which the future of Indian democracy would be a dystopia and the nation would become a panopticon with the state at the watchtower surveilling over its own citizens. Thank you.